Journey, Montreal Alouettes, Calgary Stampeders, here in a windswept McMahon Stadium. Hello, Canada, coast to coast to coast, and those of you watching in the United States on ESPN.
And there's John Cornish, the league's most outstanding Canadian player and most outstanding player, Canada's top professional athlete in 2013. What do you do for an encore, John Cornish? And on the other side, trying to shut him down, league's most outstanding defensive player, linebacker Chip Cox, career highs in tackles, sacks, and interceptions, the key to the Alouette D.
Tom Higgins is back, where he once coached in Calgary back in 2008, and then went to the league office as the director of officiating. The guy who took over for Tom Higgins, John Huffnagel. Grey Cup win in 2008, of course, and could not get his team to the Grey Cup game last year. And that is still bitter for the Calgary Stampeders, losing to Saskatchewan in the West Final. A 14-4 season last year, 8-10 for the Alouettes. There's the Stampeders' new returner, inheriting the number of Larry Taylor, who is with Montreal again. That's Jock Sanders. Sean White getting ready to kick this into a very, very strong wind. And only one returner, and it's Sanders back. Here we go, season underway. And look at this kick, way up in the air. And instant field position now for Bo Levi Mitchell, the tall Texan who gets his first start in a CFL season opener.
People will ask the question, why did Bo Levi Mitchell end up named as the Calgary Stampeders starter over Drew Tate? You see the numbers, 94 completions in 135 attempts, 10 touchdown passes versus 3 interceptions. Great numbers. His numbers are actually even better when you isolate it to the 3 starts in which he was undefeated.
Bo Levi Mitchell with Drew Tate as the backup. First and 10 from their 41, and only appropriate that John Cornish should get the first touch of 2014 after a sensational 2013, a season for the ages.
No question, beyond the awards, John Cornish led all starting running backs in yards, yards per carry, and rushing touchdowns. Bo Levi Mitchell, all quarterbacks above 100 attempts. He had the second best quarterback rating in the league behind Ricky Ray. And of course, this represents the return of Nick Lewis, who missed the final 11 games last season with that broken ankle.
First and 10 for the Stamps. There's the pitch this time to last year's most outstanding player in the Canadian Football League. The Lou Marsh Trophy winner is Canada's most outstanding athlete, John Cornish. Here are the starters to watch defensively for the Montreal Alouettes.
And Chip Cox, we mentioned, he became a much bigger part of the pass rush last season, a career high with 12 sacks. Watch for Aaron Lavarius. In name, he moves from defensive end to middle linebacker. He'll still be on the line of scrimmage a lot. And on that short side corner, the boundary corner, is Jeff Tisdale, former Ticat and Stampeder, led the CFL with 7 picks a year ago.
Waiting to whistle this in, our referee today is Kim Murphy. Second down and 9. There's Jeff Tisdale. The Alouette defense kept this team in it right into the playoffs last year. Their offense, with Anthony Calvillo out, did not do that well, and so the defense forged their way to the postseason. Back to pass, Bo Mitchell, and behind his intended target, that's number 86, Anthony Parker. So now Calgary will bring out its kick team. Rob Maver, the all-star punter from last year for the Stampeders, will kick it back to the Alouettes.
And as you mentioned earlier, back to receive for the Montreal Alouettes, Larry Taylor.
Larry Taylor, whose career began in Montreal, of course, was the most outstanding special teams player for the Owls before moving on to the Calgary Stampeders the last few seasons. Big kick with the wind, goes way over his head, and Taylor is not going to return this one. He'll give up the single point on a booming punt from Rob Maver. So the Alouettes will bring their offense on the field. 78-yard kick that time. It's 1-0, but here comes the former Heisman Trophy winner starting the season as the starter in Montreal. And is brought to you by Nissan. Innovation that excites. The single on the punt by Rob Maver, 1-0 Calgary. There's Troy Smith, the former Heisman Trophy winner, Ohio State Buckeye, came to the Alouettes last season, got a couple of starts. Now in the shadows of Anthony Calvillo, he switched his number from 3 to number 1. He is the number 1 guy now for the Owls. Brandon Whitaker is also with the Alouettes right now and over the top and looking for a receiver downfield, and there's Chad Johnson right away trying to go to Ocho Cinco, but he can't haul it in. Chad Johnson comes to the CFL from his career in the NFL.
Well, no shortage of big names south of the border in this Alouette offense. You see the numbers on Troy Smith last year. Jock Climie alluded to that concern, the 52.6% completion rate. That needs to get better in year two. The go-to guy in the receiving corps, S.J. Green, takes over Jamel Richardson. Now gone on the offensive line, Luc Brodeur-Jourdain anchors this unit in the middle.
Second and 10, again against the wind. This one flutters a bit, and Eric Delorier gathers it in up near the first down marker. They'll have to see where the spot is. Might be a couple yards shy for the Alouettes here.
Pretty good protection from that Alouette offensive line, sliding to their right. Finds Delorier in the hole, but just short of that first down yardage, forcing the Owls into a punt situation.
Jamar Wall making the tackle. This is going to be very interesting against this wind. You saw that opening kickoff that basically went like a fly ball into center field. Sean White, 43.8 yard average last season, as Tom Higgins gets his troops ready here. See where this one goes. Right into the breeze. Here comes the rush, and oh, there's a penalty. Alouettes will get the ball back here because they just dusted Sean White. They were going for the block. They blocked it all right, or tried to block it, but they knocked down Sean White. The Owls will get the ball back here, roughing the kicker for sure.
Major foul, roughing the kicker. Calgary, number 31, 15 yards, automatic first down.
You're going to see pressure coming off both edges here. This is a big concern. Obviously, the Alouettes are happy to get the ball back, but they've got to be more than a little bit worried about their punt protection unit after seeing how close the Stampeders came there.
It's receiver Jeff Fuller, who was in on the play along with Lynn J. Shell. They collided and they bounced into Sean White. There's Fuller, son of Jeff Fuller Sr., the former Super Bowl champion with the San Francisco 49ers, getting a chance here with the Stampeders. And off up the middle, up to the 53-yard line. And Brandon Whitaker back in the lineup for the Alouettes after some injury issues.
Trying to control Brandon Whitaker on that Calgary defense. Corey Mace makes his return after being injured in week one last season. Charleston Hughes, one of the most dominant defensive players in the Canadian Football League. 27 sacks in his last 27 games played. Deron Mayo out of Old Dominion, the weak side linebacker, second on the staff with 57 tackles a year ago.
Starters to watch brought to you by Napa Auto Parts, where custom advice comes standard. Throwing it out to the far side, and incomplete. Fred Bennett, as they look for Chad Johnson once again. Incomplete pass. Fred Bennett thought he had a pick.
Major foul. Roughing
another penalty here, roughing the passer. And right now, these Calgary Stampeders are a little too amped up. This will keep the drive alive again for the Owls.
Yeah, that was called on linebacker Keon Raymond, who came on the blitz. Just followed through on that hit after the ball was thrown by Troy Smith. Tremendous break on the ball for Fred Bennett. And as Chad Johnson's going to learn, when you're on the wide side of the field, that's a long throw, even if you're only 5 yards downfield. You got to come back to your quarterback.
All eyes on Chad Johnson, quite naturally. Dwayne Ford, including those DBs. Johnson, Ocho Cinco, 11 seasons in the NFL with the Cincinnati Bengals. Finished it off with the New England Patriots. 6-time Pro Bowler. Very excited, says he's nervous to play. And I would imagine Brandon Whitaker is too. This is a guy who had his knee reconstructed a couple of seasons ago, missed a lot of last season with a hamstring pull.
And Brandon Whitaker, when he's at his best, he is one of the best in the business, an all-round performer, obviously terrific ball carrier, great blocker, and a very good receiver out of the backfield. For me, that 2011 season for Brandon Whitaker this guy to me was one of the top three or four players in the entire Canadian Football League prior to getting hit by the injury bug.
Second down and two, short yardage play now. Whitaker in the backfield. Takes the handoff and will move the sticks. Alouettes haven't had many changes in the offseason. Naturally, though, it's a new era with Tom Higgins. One of the key missing pieces is Jamel Richardson, who is no longer with this team, who was surprising cut at cut down day. But Jamel Richardson is actually here in the house.
Yeah, Jamel Richardson in the building. He had some medical tests done yesterday by the Calgary Stampeders staff. One of the teams that has obviously kicked the tires on the perennial 1,000-yard receiver since his release from Montreal last week.
Ninth play of this drive, again, against the wind here. Smith hangs in, not for long. Down he goes. And Charleston Hughes, who last year led the CFL in sacks, Corey Mace was in as well, but Charleston Hughes had 18 sacks last year. This is number one for 2014.
And Charleston Hughes is going to come off the defensive right side, bottom of your screen, slide protection going away from you. You're putting that back in a real tough situation, trying to block one of the best pass rushers in the league, one-on-one in space. You want to try and get him a little bit of help, keeping him tight to the rest of that offensive line group.
Second down and long, 18 to go here from the Calgary 30-yard line. Smith out of the shadow there. Whitaker, a little stutter step, and then he falls down to the turf. And they'll have to bring the kick team out. And again, it'll be very interesting into the wind to see what kind of range Sean White will have here today. This will come from about the 38-yard line, almost the 39-yard line.
Alouettes much aided by Calgary Stampeder penalties on that drive, giving them an opportunity to get some points on the board here. As far as execution on the last play, things set up nicely for the screen, but the offensive line didn't do a great job getting bodies on bodies down the field. Brandon Whitaker didn't have a whole lot of help.
Again, into the breeze, White puts it up, and it's hooked left. And Jock Sanders decides to bring it out. And he's tripped up by Dave Stalla on what might have saved a big gainer. Flag on the play. When we come back, last year's most outstanding player back on the field at McMahon Stadium. John Cornish did it all last year for the Calgary Stampeders. Guy who knows the guy on the other sideline very well. And on our sideline today is Jermaine Franklin. Jermaine?
Thanks, Rod. You know, John Cornish's lasting memory of playing for Tom Higgins isn't a pleasant one. The year 2007, his rookie season under Tom Higgins, he was the backup to Joffrey Reynolds, then superstar running back.
We've lost Jermaine's microphone. We'll get to that story in a moment as Cornish is stopped at the line of scrimmage but then goes forward. Let's go back to Jermaine. Well, actually, he's
then superstar running back, Rod, excuse me. And then Joffrey Reynolds, he was the backup, obviously, so he's relegated to the bench and then special teams. However, fast forward to the last game of the season, and Joffrey Reynolds is rested for the playoffs. Unfortunately for Cornish, he believed that he would be starting that game in front of friends and family in his hometown of Vancouver. That did not happen. Instead, Higgins decided to activate Ken Simonton off the practice roster. Cornish never forgot. He says he forgives, but he's going to try and show what he should have shown in that first year in the last game of the season.
Oh, a nice catch made by Jeff Fuller on the pass from Bo Levi Mitchell. Interesting story, that one, with John Cornish and what he did years later. That's a 9-yard gain. The Stampeders were backed up to the one, by the way, after an infraction on that return. So it's a long field here, and this is a great catch.
Well, Bo Levi Mitchell owes Jeff Fuller a big thank you for saving him a potential pick six there. Jeff Tisdale with blanket coverage, but Fuller does a nice job getting the arms fully extended to catch the ball in front of the defender.
There he is again, John Cornish, for 1,800 yards in rushing, 14 touchdowns, 12 on the ground last year. Again, most outstanding player in the Canadian Football League. What does he do for an encore?
Well, it's going to be a tough one to follow up, but I'm sure John Cornish would trade all of those individual accolades for a Grey Cup. The Stampeders obviously very disappointed to lose to the Saskatchewan Rough Riders in the West Division Final here at home last season.
Native of New Westminster, BC, went, played his college ball in Kansas before coming back home and playing with the Stampeders. Bo Mitchell sends them out, and now out of the pocket, and he's caught there and sacked, and now a penalty coming to the Alouettes, it looks like. They were a little too aggressive. Chris Wilson coming off the edge. We'll have to see what the call is here from Kim Murphy. But Bo Levi Mitchell clearly caught and dropped.
Major foul, face masking. Montreal, number 95. 15 yards from the original point of line of scrimmage. First down.
Well, that celebration premature because this is what happened.
Well, Chris Wilson, the defensive end, he's going to come free. Great use of the hands there on Edward Harrison to get around the edge. But he also gets up high with those hands on the tackle.
Yeah. Well, there it is right there. It's underneath.
That right hand tugging Mitchell down. Unintentional, but 15 yards nonetheless for the former BC Lion.
Spent 5 years in the NFL with Washington and Philadelphia. Played 80 games and on the sideline now before coming back to the CFL. Now Cornish running room left side. Oh, and he's hit hard out there by Chris Smith.
Chris Smith, the newcomer in that Montreal secondary. We've seen both he and Jeff Tisdale on the short side have to come up from that defensive backfield to make tackles. And their support in the run game is going to be so important to controlling John Cornish and the Calgary Stampeder offense here today.
First-year player out of Brightonton, Florida, out of Northern Illinois, Chris Smith. Second down and eight here. Just a 1-0 game, a single scored on a long punt by Rob Maver. Bo Levi Mitchell going deep here for Fuller. He's got it. No wonder John Huffnagel has kept this guy around. Jeff Fuller, who played three games in 2013, only had 15 catches, however, in those games. Again, his dad played with the San Francisco 49ers, won a couple Super Bowls.
Now, if you want to hit the deep ball like that, it all starts with the protection at the line of scrimmage. Max protection there from the Stampeders, keeping both backs in. Seven-man protection scheme, giving Fuller time to get open deep. Perfect strike from Mitchell. Fuller goes up and gets the ball at its peak.
Fuller, who impressed enough last season, sticks around this season. Big target, 6'4", 217 out of Texas A&M. Bo Mitchell goes down the sideline again. Why not? He's gone! He looked like he had that ball, and already Jeff Fuller has made a couple of highlight reel catches, almost had a third.
Had it and lost it as he came down. One of the big things that Jeff Fuller provides to this Calgary Stampeder receiving corps, big target, 6'3", 6'4". You see the confidence that Bo Levi Mitchell has to just put the ball up and let Jeff Fuller go get it.
Three and a half to go here, opening quarter. Season opening game for both teams. Home opener for the Calgary Stampeders against these Alouettes. Out of the backfield now. Cornish cuts back the other way, and he is rocked. Loses his helmet, but he's up. And again, close to a first down. We'll see where the spot is here. Looks like Rene Paradis is going to come out. They're going to be about third and two here, Dwayne.
Stampeders looking to get some points on the board in this ball game. Not going to gamble with the third down situation.
Bo Mitchell stays into hold for Rene Paradis. Has been nothing but money the last couple of seasons. Around 93%, 38 yarder, and what else? Guy who set a record for consecutive field goals made last season. John Cornish off and running, getting rocked there. Stamps lead 4-0. All of us in Canada delighted to welcome ESPN to the family here in the Canadian Football League. All the regular season games, East-West Finals. See all the games this season on ESPN today on ESPN2. So welcome to the viewers in the United States. I know Bo Levi Mitchell was talking about his family watching in Texas today. And Troy Smith talking about his family and friends. So all of the American players will be covered well this season in the United States watching CFL football. So welcome to all of you. Brandon Whitaker former Baylor Bear, up the middle, close to a first down. Should give a little indoctrination maybe to some of the people who have never seen the Canadian game before. 110-yard field, 20-yard end zone, 65 yards wide. There is a lot of room up here.
A lot of room, 12 players each side, of course. Three downs. See the ball in the air a little bit more, and one of the biggest things that I think adds to the excitement of this game, of course, 20-second play clock. It is a fast-paced game.
Rule changes we'll get into this year as well. Penalty interference, pass interference could actually be challenged for the first time in football. And already we've had one game this season. We saw a challenge the other night as the Blue Bombers opened their season with a win against the Toronto Argonauts as Whitaker goes up the gut again. And Tom Higgins and the Alouettes doing a good job eating up the clock here, only giving up 4 points, because it looks like, by all accounts, this win could be a huge factor in this game.
Yeah, well, I wondered philosophically early when the Owls came out and threw the ball on the first two plays, but now you see against the wind, Brandon Whitaker getting more involved.
Trouble that time again. Calgary Stampeders converge quickly. Juwan Simpson, ferocious front seven of the Stampeders.
Yeah, Stampeders didn't bite at all after a couple of positive runs from Brandon Whitaker. Good time to go with a little play action, let Troy Smith use the legs and get to the outside. But Charleston Hughes, one of the CFL's top defenders, not fooled at all.
Second down and 10 now. Minute left in this opening quarter. Troy Smith will send out six receivers and the strong arm to the far side. Pass is caught out there by Kenny Stafford of Toledo University out of Columbus, Ohio.
Stafford played a handful of games last season for the Calgary Stampeders after being released by the Alouettes in training camp. Let go this offseason, this past offseason by the Stamps. Returned to Montreal after a terrific preseason. Made the roster this time around.
Well, they came at Sean White last time. This time they set up the return. That's a good kick, spiraling kick into the wind. And Jock Sanders, nowhere to go downfield. There is a flag. We'll sort that out when we come back to McMahon Stadium. Season opener for the Stampeders and Alouettes. ...2014 CFL opening weekend continues. Adam Big Hill and Mike Riley will see a lot of each other coming up after this game. Edmonton and BC plays to take on the Lions. I think it was a pretty good insurance policy for the BC Lions to go out and get Kevin Glenn, who was with the Stampeders last season.
Well, absolutely brilliant trade for the BC Lions. I said it on draft day. I thought if Ottawa waited until the season started, they could get a higher price for Kevin Glenn. You think of, with Travis Lule going on that six-game injured list to start the season, what the Lions might have been willing to pay for a proven starter right now.
There still are some Kevin Glenn jerseys out there. Glenn with the Stampeders last couple of seasons. One of the best insurance policies this league has ever seen, because he helped tutor Bo Levi Mitchell and Drew Tate. And above all else, he became the starting quarterback for Calgary. So Mitchell backed up again. Time ticking down in this first quarter. Changes the play now. Cornish in the backfield. Deep drop for Bo Mitchell. And a deep toss now. Downfield, and it is caught in stride. Mo Price is going to take it to the house. 102 yards. Touchdown strike. Bo to Mo. The first major of 2014, Maurice Price.
Well, so many threats in this Calgary offense. This guy might be the biggest of the big play threats. The speedster on the outside, Mo Price, gets in behind the defense. Bo Levi Mitchell throws a strike with that big win behind him. Nobody's going to catch Mo Price, maybe the fastest player in the Canadian Football League.
Speedster out of Orlando, Florida, and Charleston Southern. Seven touchdowns last year. His first of 2014. And for all of the first quarter up until the last play, the Montreal Alouettes did a great job defensively against the Stampeders, who had the wind. And Mo Price flies like the wind. Touchdown score. 11-0 Stamps after one quarter in Calgary. First quarter was a wash for about 14 minutes and 45 seconds. Then the Alouettes gave up that touchdown to Maurice Price. Calgary Stampeders lead 11-0 in their home opener for 2014. Remember when you were growing up and the quarterback said to you in the huddle, just go deep? I think that's what Bo Levi Mitchell basically did on that play.
Yeah, maybe a little bit of sandlot football, but no, knowing Dave Dickinson, the offensive coordinator for the Calgary Stampeders, this was just great play calling in terms of understanding the situation. He knows this is a strong wind. It's going to be a factor. You've got one more play with it behind you in this half. Let's take a shot. And it worked out perfectly for Bo Mitchell, Mo Price, and the rest of the Calgary Stampeders.
So now they switch sides. Calgary will kick into the breeze. Montreal will have the benefit. And keep in mind, Troy Smith has one of the strongest arms around. Bo Levi Mitchell tossed a missile that time, but reviews on Troy Smith's arm from his head coach and previous coaches, one of the reasons why he won the Heisman Trophy in 2006. This one is pooched, almost an onside. It is an onside kick, and the Alouettes wisely just gather it in, so they'll have instant field position near their 45-yard line.
With this win, we saw Sean White's opening kickoff. We'll take a look back. Mo Price is on the outside here. Keep an eye on the corner on him. He's going to stay down. Chris Smith is going to stay down. He's going to cover the flat. He gets a jam on Price, lets him go. But there's another vertical down the middle with Jeff Fuller. Free safety. Marco Briette goes with that. That leaves Price free on that other vertical on the outside. Mitchell finds him. Result, touchdown Stamps.
Bo Mitchell's first touchdown toss of the new season and his first start. Again, undefeated as a starter. 3-0 last season as a starter. And up the middle, Brandon Whitaker again. Big gainer on the ground for the Alouettes, who would love to get that ground game going again. When Brandon Whitaker wasn't in the lineup, they struggled offensively.
Well, you've got to believe with a first-year starter at quarterback, after Anthony Calvillo having been in that position what seemed like forever, and it being such a pass-oriented offense, you got to believe Brandon Whitaker is going to be a key for the Alouettes this year, that they're going to get the ball in his hands a little bit more often to take the pressure off Troy Smith.
Life AC for the Alouettes after Calvillo, and this time swallowed up at the line of scrimmage again by Charleston Hughes. He told me yesterday that it all starts on game one. The new attitude for the Stampeders still stinging after last year's Western final loss to Saskatchewan.
Watch Charleston Hughes. He's going to be right on the outside, his usual defensive end position. Now he's crashing down hard, not honoring. You see Troy Smith coming around the end on that bootleg. Smith's going to have to pull the ball and show off his legs a little bit, show his mobility, and that's going to hold the defensive end and help out Brandon Whitaker on the run play.
Loss of one on the play, passing down. There's Troy Smith, and this one far side. It is intercepted. Fred Bennett has pick number one.
Bennett thought he had one earlier, as they tried to throw to that wide side to Chad Johnson. Bennett comes up with one here, picks it off the ground. The shoestring interception.
Troy Smith, 2 of 5 and a pick. Calgary has the ball back. There's new defensive coordinator Rich Stubler in the middle. An ex-Houston Texan, Fred Bennett, interception here, and Calgary has the football back.
And again, it's that long throw out to the wide side, but not getting it out there. Fred Bennett steps in front of Chad Johnson to get the interception.
Troy Smith, who struggled in his only preseason start a week ago against the Ottawa Redblacks with his accuracy.
Well, accuracy has always been the knock on Troy Smith. Obviously, tremendously strong arm, terrific leader, has so many of the intangibles you want, great mobility, which I think is going to be an asset. But just that accuracy is going to continue to be a work in progress for the Owls' second-year quarterback.
Bo Mitchell throws it away on the far sideline. Two young quarterbacks who get a chance to start season openers for the first time against each other, and Bo Levi Mitchell, the 24-year-old, and again Troy Smith, who's a bit older at 29, though, again, and had some time in the NFL with Baltimore, but never latched on there. Went to the UFL and then eventually to the CFL here with the Alouettes. 11-0 Stamps, second and 10. There's the rush. Mitchell hangs in, and this one is thrown away. So after the turnover, Stamps will give it back. So no harm done despite that pick.
Well, nice job getting pressure here from this Montreal Alouette defense. This is their calling card. Created so many turnovers last year simply by the frenetic pace at which they play, number of guys that they send after the quarterback, basically outnumbering the number of blockers, hurry the quarterback into making mistakes. You saw how it impacted the accuracy of Bo Levi Mitchell on that throw.
Rob Maver spirals it into the wind. Larry Taylor trying to find a couple of seams. He cannot. Good coverage downfield from the special teams. There's big Charleston Hughes. Sack man from last year. Sack leader in the CFL. Already off to a great start in the new season as it's begun here today in Calgary. ...28-year-old out of Saginaw, Michigan, Charleston Hughes. Last year led the Canadian Football League in taking down quarterbacks.
Well, that's 18 sacks in 16 games played for Charleston Hughes. Missed a couple of games last season. By my count, the last guy to average more than a sack a game in a season in this league. One Cameron Wake.
Down in the NFL now. Motion now for Troy Smith. Get it together. There's a good slant pattern, far side. Deron Carter's first touch of 2014. 12-yard pickup for Deron Carter. What a breakthrough breakout season last year. Charleston Hughes loves the fact that he's got a guy that he can really communicate on that sideline. New defensive coordinator, guy who's been around, Rich Stubler. First and 10 from the 40. Smith is brought down. Quinn Evans, one of the newcomers for the Calgary Stampeders, bringing down Troy Smith with another sack, 12-yard loss for the Montreal Alouettes.
It looked like Smith was going to escape to the outside, but Evans just tripped him up. Evans starts on the inside of that defense. Fights through a double team working to the outside. I suspect as this game goes on, we may see the Montreal Alouettes try to move that pocket around a little bit more for Troy Smith. Get him on the move.
Here they come again. Now out of the backfield and nowhere to go. Ball's on the turf. And it looks like the Stampeders have it. Brandon Whitaker dropped the football. Sean Lemon has it in his mitts. And I think this is Calgary football. There was no whistle. Another costly Alouette turnover.
Not a lot of protesting from Brandon Whitaker, but we'll take another look here to see exactly when the ball popped out. Again, they set up the screen, but the blockers aren't getting up to the middle linebacker, Juwan Simpson. It looks like he's down before that ball comes out. He's watching for a challenge flag here from Tom Higgins on the Montreal sideline. Watch the right knee down, still has possession of the ball. That ball's not out until Brandon Whitaker is down. Down by contact, this should remain Montreal ball.
The previous play is under review by the command center.
So they'll take a look at this at the command center. There's Tom Higgins. First game back in the Canadian Football League after six away as the director of officiating. Used to look at some of this stuff, as a matter of fact.
The previous play is under review by the command center.
This one appears that it should be a pretty easy decision for the command center. But very surprising not to see the Alouettes, and especially Brandon Whitaker, as they just went off the field. There wasn't a lot of protesting and not a lot of, no big demonstration from them. But clearly the challenge.
So they're looking at it now, and Calgary already had an interception. Now a possibility of a fumble recovery. Good start for the Stampeders here. That long bomb again from Bo Mitchell to Mo Price. One more time. They're getting a lot of looks at this. Kind of bobbled it a little bit there, but looked like he had possession.
See it in real time.
John Huffnagel, the guy who took over from Tom Higgins here in Calgary and led his team to the Grey Cup, of course, in 08. His team has had a terrific home record under Huff through the years. Here is the verdict now from CFL Command.
After
will this
review,
be overturned?
The Montreal player caught the ball, was down by contact at the 25-yard line. Montreal will retain possession. The play has been overturned by replay. It will be third down at the 25.
So it's still third down. Calgary still gets the ball back, but they would have had the ball at the 25-yard line. So Jock Sanders goes back, and Sean White has the benefit of the gale behind him. This is an end-over-ender. Bounces near the 40. Former Rough Rider Sanders has the edge and brings it up near the 50-yard line. Kick of 57 yards, a return of 28 for Jock Sanders. We knew it was going to be a Texas quarterback starting, either Drew Tate or Bo Levi Mitchell. Their coach says the decision came down to the wire.
You know, it was a photo finish. We said it was an open quarterback competition throughout training camp. They performed, both of them performed very well. Gut decision, if anything else. They're excellent teammates, and no matter which way I went with it, the other quarterback would have done everything he could to get himself ready to play and also help out the person who started.
Bo Mitchell got the start over Drew Tate. Two of them together the last couple seasons here in Calgary, and one time it looked like this was going to be Drew Tate's team.
Well, Drew Tate took over this team from Henry Burris, but has battled injuries ever since, and nobody has said it, but I do think that that's a factor in the decision. Obviously, we've seen in Winnipeg over the last couple of years where Buck Pierce battled injuries a lot, and ultimately you have guys who aren't taking the reps during the week doing a lot of the playing on game day when you've got the starting quarterback getting hurt.
Great protection that time as he threads the needle. Goes up the middle for Marquay McDaniel. 1,000-yard season for the former Hamilton Tiger Cat. Marquay makes his first catch in 2014 up near the 45.
Yeah, first career 1,000-yard season for him. Was very close in Hamilton a couple of years ago, but he's become a mainstay here in Calgary and cracked the CFL on TSN top 50 players list here in 2014.
A list, as usual, that is met with some controversy from some of the players, as you might imagine. Well, Bo Levi Mitchell, his big coming out party was against these Alouettes a year ago.
Yeah, on and relieve. He's always been a situational guy playing that short yardage offense and so on, but got a little bit of extra playing time against the Owls, 7-13, 49 yards and a couple of touchdown passes last season. Served as something of a springboard what was really a breakout year for the young quarterback out of Eastern Washington.
Largest comeback in CFL history after one quarter. The Stamps were down 24-0 and came back and won the game as he tried to sidearm one in back to Marquay McDaniel, but it was a no-go. What a comeback that was against these Owls, and they swept the Alouettes back-to-back weeks last year in early July. So now Rene Paradis and will not come out. It will be Rob Maver, and against the wind. This is almost have to be a 60-yard kick, even though it would be 48 yards with that breeze today. So Maver will try to angle this one with Larry Taylor back. Look at this thing flutter. What a kick. Good one inside the 10-yard line. Down near the 8-yard line, a 34-yard punt, but the direction was perfect.
Exactly. No style points there, but in terms of the end result, Rob Maver got exactly what he wanted.
Former Guelph Griffin, selected number 5 overall for the Stampeders back in 2010. Originally was here as a field goal kicker as well, and then along came Rene Paradis.
Well, yeah, it's interesting the way things work out. Maver was a guy who did all three and did all three very well in college, but the Stampeders were looking for a place kicker to replace Sandro DeAngelis. Maver came in and did that job and didn't punt. The door was open for Rene Paradis the next year when Maver got hurt.
Smith, and again, there's that issue with the accuracy for Troy Smith as he was looking out for Jerron Carter. The Heisman Trophy winner has struggled the last couple of weeks, last week in the preseason and this week, finding receivers.
And it's been an interesting road for Troy Smith getting here to the Canadian Football League from Ohio State. The Montreal Alouettes kept this young man on their negotiation list for over 7 years, waiting, hoping, anticipating that he might one day be their starting quarterback in the heir apparent to Anthony Calvillo. That time has finally come.
Now he tries to zip one in again, looking for Jerron Carter back to back, and another two and out for this Alouettes offense that is struggling. Still a zero on the board.
And it seems to me that one of the things that they've done fairly effectively when they've committed to it has been running the ball with Brandon Whitaker. They've had some success, they've had some positive plays. I'd like to see that become a bigger part of the Alouette offense. Again, Troy Smith, 30 years old, but young in terms of CFL experience. Let's take a little bit of pressure off the quarterback.
Sean White is in his end zone. Big, big boot. Chalk Sanders, hot potato on the sideline, knocked out of bounds. Well, Tom Higgins knows that Anthony Calvillo casts a long shadow, but his team can help Troy Smith out.
If we can, we need to make sure that he doesn't have to carry the football team. We would like to make sure we can establish a run. We can have short passes, as well as he has the ability to throw the football long. He has a strong arm, and he has something that you're looking for, is that leadership quality. So where Anthony had all of those things, but had all of that experience, he just doesn't have the experience.
Experience is something you can only gain when you gain it, right? Now this is the time to get it. Smith played a couple of games last year. Bo Mitchell downfield and almost picked off. Jeff Tisdale, who led the CFL in interceptions a year ago, almost had his first.
Tisdale gets the hands on the receiver right off the line as he's working against Mo Price. Got away with a pretty good clutch right there to prevent any separation. Good reaction to the football there from the DB Tisdale.
Second down and 10. Just over 6 to go before halftime. Look out, Bo Mitchell has to dance now. And from behind, he is brought down by Aaron Laverius. Again, a guy who's listed as the middle linebacker, but he's playing off that line. And Aaron Laverius comes in and drops Bo Mitchell.
Yeah, this is the role of the middle linebacker in the Montreal Alouette defense. You typically expect to find 97 back here, but he's going to line up on the line of scrimmage. Noel Thorpe, their defensive coordinator, says we need our middle linebacker because of his role to have a defensive end skill set. Laverius very productive as a defensive end a year ago. On that play, you saw exactly why. Very quick off the edge.
One of the holes the Alouettes had to fill, of course, at middle linebacker Shea Emery, now a Toronto Argonaut. Alouettes set up this return now. Taylor takes it on the hop, reverses field, and smothered again down near the 22-yard line. From the creator of Lost and director of Friday Night Lights comes a new HBO original series, The Leftovers. Series premiere tomorrow at 10 Eastern, only on HBO Canada. Contact your TV provider to subscribe. I don't think that's a show that you'd be watching.
Not my thing.
Leftovers. You're never around leftovers, are you? Okay? There's never any leftovers. Looks good, though. And the Alouettes trying to get something going here. Offense last year, the net offense in the Canadian Football League, second last. Nice catch on the far side. And Chad Johnson has his first in the Canadian Football League. And right up and chirping is Ocho Cinco. Chad Johnson, who has huge numbers, including in the Twitter world, 3.6 million followers. Look at all the numbers there that he has put up on the field. He's put up enormous numbers off the field, too. And that's his first official catch in the Canadian Football League.
Well, those are the only numbers the Montreal Alouettes are concerned about, will be the ones that he puts up wearing their red, white, and blue going forward.
First down, Brandon Whitaker. Well, Chad Johnson's been around, of course, 11 seasons, six times a Pro Bowler, and what he did in the end zone is what set him apart and made him a fan favorite in some places and an enemy in others. You know, it's around the same time that Chad Johnson was doing that Nick Lewis was pointing out. The Calgary Stampeders were inventing their own touchdown celebrations, only they weren't solo acts, they were choreographed. And by the way, in case Sean White ever has an issue, Ocho Cinco can also kick, as he did in the National Football League.
Well, they're kicking an extra point for the Cincinnati Bengals, and just to show he's not limited to the short ones, stepped up close to 50 yards in pregame warm-up today. One shot, nailed it.
One of the most colorful characters in pro football for sure, and from all accounts has been a model citizen with the Alouettes. Smith now, pump fake, now in traffic, throws far side again, dangerous. Brad Bennett again, he's got daylight too, and Bennett comes backwards, still on his feet. There is a penalty flag, and Troy Smith couldn't bring down Bennett. Brad Bennett's still on his feet. He's got blocking help now. Look out. Bennett's going to take it down to the 6-yard line. What a pick. What a return. But there is a penalty flag.
And this flag was down early in the play. This was not on the return. So this could be all for naught for Fred Bennett and the Calgary Stampeder D.
Troy Smith went flying at Fred Bennett. Couldn't knock him off his feet. And yet another ball that ends up in the hands of the Calgary Stampeders in this first half.
Major foul, unnecessary roughness. Calgary, number 42, horse collar tackle. 15 yards, automatic first down.
So the Alouettes catch a break here. Daron Mayo with the horse collar.
And Daron Mayo right in the middle of that Calgary Stampeder defense. He's coming on the loop. Watch the right hand very clearly on the back collar of Troy Smith's jersey.
3-minute warning has been issued to both sidelines. We'll step aside and come back. Stamps lead 11-0.
See the penalty numbers there for the Calgary Stampeders. Most recently, Daron Mayo and the horse collar tackle. Watch number 42 will show up in the middle of your screen. Right hand, right there. Grabbing Troy Smith just as he threw that football. So not only is the interception erased, but 15 yards forward for the Alouettes.
Far side again, and hauling it in, his second reception is Chad Johnson. Then Jay Shell down there covering Ocho Cinco, 12-yard pickup.
Smith finding his range on that wide side throw. Johnson doing a nice job getting the feet down. Just inbounds there. Linjay Shell has come in to replace Fred Bennett as the wide side corner right now, because Bennett was pretty gassed after that long interception return.
Troy Smith, hot shot over to S.J. Green. That's his first catch. S.J. Green, an all-star in 2013. The stars of the South Florida Bulls a few years ago. He had a 1,000-yard season last year on 83 catches. And again, the super slots, they've been called in Montreal, catching balls from Anthony Calvillo the last couple of seasons, really the last four or five seasons. S.J. Green, Jamel Richardson. No Jamel Richardson now again for Montreal. That's why Chad Johnson and Kenny Stafford getting a chance here with the Owls. And that's way offside. Penalty flag flies, and this is likely going to come back and be nullified.
And it appeared to be Kenny Stafford who jumped a little bit early on that one.
Troy Smith really getting Chad Johnson involved in.
Well, Stampeders laid off a little bit, particularly Linjay Shell, who's an experienced CFL defensive back,
offside,
but hasn't played a lot
Montreal,
on the corner.
Number 19, 5-yard penalty, remains second down.
Shell in there as a substitute, and he's respecting the speed. Number 85.
Jay Shell, the former Argo, 3 years there. Last two seasons with the BC Lions.
Yeah, Linjay Shell and free safety Josh Bell both came over from BC during the offseason, along with their defensive coordinator, Rich Stubler.
Second down and 9. Smith now. Here they come again. He's in trouble again. And he tries to throw it away. They sank his gown. His knee was down, so that's a sack.
Corey Mace suffered a season-ending shoulder injury in week one last year, but showing he's made it all the way back here in 2014. It's the second time we've seen him get to the quarterback.
Three sacks now from the Stampeders. Loss of 9 on the play, and once again, Sean White. 2 minutes to go before halftime.
Let him go, let him go, let him go!
Angling one this time. And a perfect kick. Absolutely perfect kick to the coffin corner from Sean White. This will pin the Stampeders.
Well, this has always been one of the strengths of Sean White's game. This is the placement of his punts. Directional punting so important here in Canadian football. Such a game of field position, the ability basically to narrow down the return options for your opponent, so important on the wide field.
The Alouettes have some work to do in the second half here in Calgary for sure. Trying to get their offense out of gear. Yards to go for the Stampeders here. And out of the backfield, John Cornish. Helmet down and brought down up near the 10-yard line. 28 yards on the ground so far for John Cornish.
Well, this is a nice job by the offensive line. You're going to see a blitz come from Marco Briette coming from that secondary spot. Offensive line on the left side, they do a nice job picking this up. Slot back Marquay McDaniel pins Briette to the inside. That allows Cornish to sneak outside. Turn what could have been a big defensive play into a positive offensive gain.
Alouettes defense, run defense, best in the Canadian Football League a year ago, and they show it again here. Cornish rushed for 199 yards in 2 games last year against Montreal. He opened the season a year ago in the win against BC with 172 yards. It was a precursor to the season he would have. Looking at this, it's going to be third down here. And they're keeping their offense on the field, or are they? Mitchell coming to the sidelines. measure this.
Well, this will be a situation where the wind could play into the decision, Rod, with a minute 23 to go here in the first half. A punt is going to leave the Alouettes and Sean White within field goal range. So the Stampeders want to keep possession of this football, even though in this territory you typically might not gamble. But they feel like either way, if they lose the ball, it's the risk of points on the board right away.
Drew Tate is in the game for this short yardage play. Well, the backup comes in now, third and one. Tate lunges forward, looks like he has it. Will return to the sideline. Minute 11 to go before halftime. Game two of this 2014 season. Season opener for both of these teams. Edmonton and BC coming up after this game. Doubleheader on this Saturday afternoon in late June.
As you see that short yardage gamble from the Calgary Stampeders, you see another one of those differences for some of the new American viewers, is that the defense has to line up a yard off the football. So typically, when all you need is a yard offensively, you should be able to get it.
Mitchell back in the gun. Keep it on the ground against the breeze. Cornish now dodges one, but not another. John Bowman, the veteran, in on the initial stop. Coming up under a minute. Welcome Rod Smith as the host of the CFL on TSN. John Climie, Matt Dunnigan, Chris Schultz. Welcome back, Roderick. Live at the half coming up. Talk about this one and set up game two of our twin bill. Really the only difference in this ball game so far. Montreal hasn't moved the football. There's a miscommunication in the backfield. And John Cornish was absolutely smothered there. They made a Cornish sandwich back there.
Timeout. Montreal.
So now Montreal will get the ball back with a few ticks left on the clock, and at the very least, with this wind, could be able to boot a field goal and put some points on the board. But really, the only difference is that long bomb, Mitchell to Price. Otherwise, it's a 4-0 game.
And that bomb that came on Calgary's last play with the wind. But it'll be interesting here to see what Calgary does. Snapping the ball from their own 10-yard line. Rob Maver's going to be receiving the snap in the end zone. Calgary could just opt to have him run around a little bit, take some time off, and take the safety.
They're not. He's going to boot it. Boots it into that wind. Taylor is going to get out of bounds, and there's a penalty flag. Looks like it could be no yards. You have to give 5 yards to the returner. That's the call. That's a big penalty here. That could take them right into the score zone. Time for one more to put it in field goal position. Pump and go here. And Deron Carter downfield can't reach out for it. So 7 seconds remain.
But it looked like Deron Carter, as he came off the ball, kind of gave that little stutter step, as you said, kind of a little bit of a hitch and go look. And didn't really take off, though.
Troy Smith had him too, Eddie.
Yeah, until the ball was in the air, it didn't look like Carter really got up to full speed, as if he wasn't expecting the ball to be coming his way.
So how costly was that 10-yard penalty? Out of field goal range, chance to put points on the board, and this could be the final play of this first half. Calgary defense pitching a shutout. Sanders. Clock at zeros. He's on the turf, and the Stampeders, one touchdown, one major. There is a penalty flag, and it's in the end zone. So there could be one more play here. Some of the players walking to the locker room. I think they see the flag on the field. They are going to decline it, it looks like. They will go to the locker rooms. The difference, Bo Mitchell and Mo Price connecting on the last play of the
Major
first quarter.
Unnecessary roughness. Montreal number 52. Penalty we apply to open the kickoff in the second half. It is halftime.
It is halftime. 11-0 Calgary Stampeders. Let's send you to the studio now. CFL Control. Here's Rod Smith and the coach, Paul LaPolice.
All right, thank you, Rod Blacker. Apologies for our signal from Calgary going down briefly there late in the half. Didn't miss any points. Not many of them scored, Coach, as we take a look at the GMC playbook. The one big play coming late in that first quarter, all the points coming in that first quarter. Talk about that 102-yard touchdown pass.
Yeah, Mo Price did a tremendous job. Beautiful throw and catch to, you know, really break their back on the last play with the wind. Let's take a look at what happened here. You're in a situation where Montreal on first and 10 came up with a blitz look. So what is hard for the secondary is they've got everybody into the line of scrimmage. They're trying to drop out into zone, but they're going to be left weak to the wide side of the field. Take a look what's happening. You got two verticals coming upfield. I'm going to pause it right here. What I'd like this corner to do is don't worry about that player who's coming out late. Carry the vertical as long as you can because the quarterback will hold the football and throw the check down. Now the halfback, he is in trouble too because he falls too far inside. He needs to split the difference to be able to make the play on both routes. Okay, so that gives a huge opportunity for him to throw it outside. Again, you got to handle yourself when you see those two threats coming upfield. You'd like that corner to be able to, Rod, to be able to carry that a little bit longer.
Coach, in the first quarter especially, it looked like Troy Smith and the Alouettes really struggling to move the football against the wind, even when Calgary was giving them some pretty significant penalties, roughing penalties there. What does Montreal have to do in the second half to just sway the momentum now?
They got to play great defense in the third because I assume Calgary's going to get the wind again. And then in the fourth quarter, they got to make plays when they get the wind.
Well, we'll see what happens. We'll have more on the CFL on TSN here at the half. But it is the Alouettes trailing in this one. A pretty stiff breeze. Calgary scoring all of its points in the first quarter with that win. More coming up. Matchup there as well with a new coach, Chris Jones, in Edmonton. Lots of changes. And Travis Lule unable to start the season for BC. So it's a good thing they did make that deal for Kevin Glenn. Let's talk more about this game coming up later today with our panel, Jock Climby, Matt Dunnigan, and Chris Schultz. BC Lions running game improving late in the season once they got Stephen Logan back in the NFL. I know that's one of the things that you're looking for in this game today.
Yeah, I can't wait to see how offensive coordinator Kahari Jones deals with the double threat. And I say deals with a double threat because I think it's a problem for him to keep both these guys engaged. They're both so talented. Andrew Harris has been used to carrying the load for the last two seasons. In fact, last year he had 60% of the Lions' carries. Well, the second Logan showed up last year for the last three games, his carries dropped to 40%. So when you're used to carrying the mail all the time and all of a sudden you are watching a guy like this do that, that can be hard on a player. You can quickly become disengaged if your offensive coordinator does not keep you involved by creating packages for you. And that is the key. I'm going to be looking to see whether Andrew Harris still has plays designed for him. Stuff coming out of the backfield. Ways to make sure that he stays a big part of this offense. Because we all know what Logan can do. We all know what Harris can do. But can they do it together on the same football team?
Schultze, like the other night, we were talking about Winnipeg. A lot of changes for a last place team, including a new head coach. As you look at the Eskimos, try to turn it around. What are you watching for?
Well, really, really intriguing team. You have a new head coach in Chris Jones. And they had a brutally physical training camp a very high-paced training camp. At one point, they'd have one offense on one side of the field and another separate offense just so they would get play after play after play. Now, two thoughts here. Anytime you have a new coach, they run practices the way they want to run practices because they want to stamp it as this is my team. This is the way we're going to do things. And the second issue is often you try to make practices so hard that the games are relatively easy. Players have expressed that through training camp going into the exhibition games. Other issue, and under the category of obvious, they got to protect their quarterback, Mike Riley. 709 yards he ran the football. Now, Matt, to me, if he has to run for 709 yards through choice or necessity or survival, I think it's a failure on the offense. I think he has to become a quarterback that continues to make plays a little bit more in the pocket.
Hard to be a quarterback when you're under pressure like that, I can tell you. I don't care who you are. Mike Riley got lit up last year. 60 times he was put on his back, and that was second worst in the league. I can tell you this, as a young quarterback, been there, done that, in that uniform, in that stadium, hey, you're just trying to survive out there, and your survival instincts often go to running the football when he can't read a defense. Mike Riley's trying to figure it out, but he'll be figuring it out in a new offense, an offense that will give him an opportunity for some outlets, for some hot reads, keep him on his feet more often so he'll be able to utilize and go through his progressions and check downs, and this will make him a better quarterback just based on Stephen McAdoo's offense this year and what's been implemented in that tough training camp you talked about.
Quick question for you. He's 230 pounds.
230, 235.
As a quarterback.
Last year he was he's 6'3". He's a big man. He can carry that, and he knowingly went out and put on that weight because he felt he was too little last year. He knew he's going to take more of a pounding this year because he's trying to figure out the game.
Right.
He's fun to watch regardless, Schultz, but I tell you what, that protection is going to be put to the test against the Lions today. I don't care who's the defensive coordinator. Was Rich Stubel last year, who the new defense coordinator is this year, Mark Washington. Those guys can bring some heat. He'll be tested.
They did make some changes in the offensive line. They're looking to protect him more, and yes, putting on those 20 pounds of muscle, to protect himself as well. We will see. That's going to be very interesting coming up. Part two of the doubleheader. In part one, halfway through it, one big play to Mo Price, 102-yarder, and the Stamps are leading it. 11-0. All right, time now to take a look at the halftime stats, Matty.
Yeah, you know, look at this, guys, right here. 175 yards passing. 102 of that was on one play. You take 102 from 199, leaves you 97 total yards for the Stamps and 69 for the Alouettes. This game is all about defense. Doesn't surprise me. Two of the best in the league last year.
That big touchdown pass thrown by Bo Levi Mitchell is standing by now with Jermaine Franklin.
Bo, take us through your 102-yard touchdown pass to Mo Price.
Got a lot of great protection. It was a great play call, really, in that sense of where we were on the field. Like I say, great protection. Mo went out there. You know, that's not easy to go track a ball in the wind like that. So, he did a great job go tracking that and beating the tackle and going to score a touchdown.
How would you assess your first half as the leader of this Stampeders offense?
It's 11-0 right now, so pretty good. Good?
Thanks.
That's a good way of putting it. Yeah. 102, one big play, and that'll certainly make you feel better heading into the second half. Well, busy day in sports, of course, on a Saturday, and not just great Canadiana with the CFL, great Canadiana overseas at Wimbledon. Gurdeep.
Held scoreless in that first half. What has to occur for this offense to get on the board and back in the game?
Execution. I was doing not so good job in the first half. I do better this half.
Is it fair to say that you and Chad Johnson are developing a chemistry?
Yeah, but everybody else on the field has to have that chemistry also. I got to do a better job at administering, giving the ball out, and we'll see what's happening.
Thanks for this.
You got it.
He's a stand-up guy. We'll see if he can rise up here in this second half. Bo Levi Mitchell, better numbers in that first half, but albeit the yardage that was accumulated by the Stampeders, most of it came in one play.
Yeah, that 102-yard pass on the last play of the first quarter, Bo Levi Mitchell to Mo Price for the major. Really the difference in this ball game. All the points scored with the win.
Well, Calgary's going to get great field position here, Dwayne, in this second half. The Alouettes won the coin toss, deferring.
At the end of the first half, we had a major foul. Montreal number 52, 15 yards on the kickoff.
As Kim Murphy said, so Montreal is opting to take the ball in the fourth with the wind. But that means they have to kick into the wind, plus the penalty. Stampeders are going to get great field position here.
Yeah, absolutely. As you said, combination of factors, wind and penalty. Almost instantly in field goal range if they get anything on the return.
Sean White has to boot into this breeze. Jock Sanders is back, former Rough Rider. Just waiting on the score clock, the stadium clock here. So far in this game, you'd have to really say that the conditions have been prevalent.
Yeah, no doubt a factor. I mean, all 11 points put on the board.
Timer. Please
with the wind at the back coming for the Stampeders in the first quarter of this football game.
They may have to tee this ball up as well. It's blown off a couple times. May have to actually get somebody to bring in and pin it. Let's stay up this time. So the Alouettes in a hole and...
an interesting decision, opting after deferring, winning the coin toss and deferring, opting to give Calgary the ball in the wind here in the third quarter.
Still waiting. They haven't put the clock back to 15 minutes here. And I should tell you that they have a brand new score board and big screen in the end zone here. There it is. Beautiful big screen at McMahon Stadium. There's the scoreboard at the bottom. You can see the zeros on the board. So they're going to wait until they can get that rectified before they start this up. Yeah, this plan here could really backfire on the Alouettes because you could get, I mean, they're already in a hole down 11-0, and they could get behind a whole bunch here.
I'm just looking at where the strength lies on this Montreal Alouette team. You almost think you'd want to be relying on your defense a little more in the fourth quarter because that's where your experience is, that's where your continuity is from last season. You're more veteran guys that you may want to rely on those guys a little more to try and protect a lead or so on in the fourth quarter than to be relying on your offense to try and score points at a big rate if they happen to be down by more after this third.
Here we go then. Sanders runs into his own teammate and is pushed back to the 50-yard line. So, old Levi Mitchell bring his offense back on the field to start this third quarter with the wind at their backs.
You look at these two quarterbacks, pretty good credentials for both of these guys coming to the Canadian Football League. Got a former Heisman Trophy winner in Troy Smith, facing a former Walter Payton Award winner in Bo Levi Mitchell. That award going to the top player in what was formerly known as Division I AA football.
Guy we haven't heard from yet today is Nick Lewis. He's not made a catch. He's got a streak going. There's Brad Sinopoli, the former quarterback turned receiver. Sinopoli into the game. Let's go to the sideline and join Jermaine again with an injury update.
Thanks, Rod. Jeff Fuller, receiver for the Stampeders, will not be back in action for this. The Stamps were not forthcoming with his injury, but what I can tell you is after laying out for a ball in the first quarter, he had his right shoulder worked on the sideline. He did get in the very next series, but we have not seen Fuller since. Jeff Fuller will not return to action in this second half.
Keeping those receivers healthy has been such a big issue for the Stampeders over the last couple of years. Joe West out to start the season. Mo Price has battled injuries as well, and now Fuller.
Going the other way now, the former Rough Rider, Jock Sanders, comes over to Calgary after winning a Grey Cup in Saskatchewan. Here is the injury to Jeff Fuller. He had two catches early on.
And two pretty big catches. One basically prevented an interception. Another, the second biggest play of the game. You saw him there go down on the play in which he was basically the guy who freed up Mo Price for the touchdown, occupying two defenders in the middle of the field to open up Price on the outside.
Second down and eight. Marquay McDaniel and Mo Price on the line, top and bottom of your screen. Bo Mitchell goes to the crosser. It is McDaniel, brought down by Marc-Olivier Briette, down near the 25-yard line.
Marquay McDaniel is going to line up as the number three receiver and work to the outside on his route. Pretty good timing here. Press to the inside to gain position on your defender. You see how that pushed Briette to the inside as he was threatened there by McDaniel, and then breaks to the outside using his release to gain separation on the route.
Interesting to note with Marc-Olivier Briette, a former quarterback in University of Montreal, now a safety for the Alouettes, and also Brad Sinopoli, a quarterback in Ottawa, now a receiver for the Stamps. And look out now, Mitchell pump fakes. What a move there by Bo Mitchell, and a hook slide down near the 16-yard line. That was a little shimmy and shake there, Bo Mitchell.
Well, I think Mitchell has maybe grown a little bit weary of hearing people suggest that Drew Tate is the Calgary quarterback, who's a little bit more creative
this.
When things become unscripted, he looked pretty good improvising on that one.
So into the red zone go the Calgary Stampeders. Alan Michael Cash was the guy that was deked out there by Bo Mitchell. Cornish gets the give here. Kyrie Saber is right there. Drop for a loss, it looks like.
For the most part, Montreal defense has done a very good job limiting the damage done by John Cornish, the league's reigning most outstanding player. Stampeders currently with 40 yards rushing in this ballgame. As you said, Cornish had 199 yards on the ground brought in two games against Montreal last season.
Just 26 in this game so far, and again against the best run defense last year, the Alouettes. Throwing down now for the Stamp, second and 10. Bad snap, look out Bo Mitchell, and down he goes! And a penalty flag flies. He was hit from behind the blind side. There was a penalty flag that flew immediately. Bo Mitchell gets blasted.
Well, that blitz came in a hurry. Watch from that offensive left side of your screen. It's Marco Briette
no
comes
on
free.
The, play. The ruling on the field is an incomplete forward pass. Third down.
So
third
no
down.
Penalty.
Unblocked man. You saw Briette with that right hand try to go for the strip. Mitchell had started the arm forward already, resulting in the incomplete pass ruling rather than a fumble.
So now it's up to the Venezuelan-born kicker, Rene Paredes, who, of course, spent time with the Concordia Stingers. Once cut by the Winnipeg Blue Bombers, ended up here and made history last season, 39 straight field goals. One for one on the day, and now two for two, and makes it a two-touchdown lead, 14-0 for the Stampeders. What a hit by Marco Briette. The Stamps have to settle for a field goal. There he is, Chad Johnson. Ocho Cinco has come to Canada, and his coach says that he has been a revelation.
Anything but a distraction. He wants to play. He wants to compete. He finds the game fascinating, and he's a fascinating individual. He's learning. Every game that he steps on the field will be a learning experience for him. And he's actually pretty in tune to what you're allowed to do and not allowed to do as a receiver, but also what you're allowed to do and not allowed to do in the end zone. And so he hasn't said what it's going to be. I can only imagine. But I do know that there'll be 11 other guys that'll be celebrating with him.
Tom Higgins, Chad Johnson, a couple catches today. His first as a member of the Canadian Football League. But Tom Higgins would like to see any of his Alouettes in the end zone right now. They've been shut out, blitzed 14-0. They're only shut out in one half last season. That was in September against BC. Troy Smith fires over the top, and there's the catch from SJ Green. That was one of the better throws by Troy Smith, but you're continually seeing that overthrow from Troy Smith. We saw so much of it last week in the preseason. We saw it on the first one. This time he fires a bullet, a strike into SJ.
Yeah, nice job as he steps up there to keep the eyes downfield. SJ Green pops open the window in the middle of the field. Smith right on the money with that one.
Chad Johnson, top of your screen. Smith looks that way. Goes to Johnson, and again, an overthrow. Just having trouble finding his receivers, pulling the trigger. A lot of those balls are sailing.
We may see the Montreal Alouettes start to look a little bit more to the short passing game and try and let Troy Smith get into a little bit of a rhythm. And again, a pass like that, not a long way down the field, but it's a long ball to throw. And especially in a wind where it's going to play a lot of games. The ball is going to move on him a lot over the course of that distance. Just try and let him get into a little bit of a rhythm.
Smith, deep drop this time, and goes deep, and again, way past the receiver, another overthrow.
And I'll make the point again, Rod, there's still 9 minutes left in the third quarter of this football game.
Yeah, you don't need that.
There's a ton of football still to be played in the world of Canadian football. This is a lifetime. To be down by 14 points, Montreal Alouettes have lots of time. They don't need to try and get 7 points in a single play. You're still in a mode a little bit where, quite frankly, working against the wind, you want to keep the clock moving a little bit too.
You saw the backups, Tanner Marsh and Alex Brink. Well, the master, of course, was Anthony Calvillo. Able to nickel and dime teams, then go for the kill shot. Penalty flag down, Jock Sanders, and brought down. That could be another flag there, almost a horse collar tackle on Sanders. See what the flag is here. Looks like no yards on the return.
No yards. Montreal, number 15-yard penalty, first 15 down.
15-yard penalty when the player catches it in the air. Another big penalty here. Last year's most outstanding defensive player in the CFL back at work when we come back to Calgary. His team didn't make it to the Grey Cup last week, but Chip Cox did during Grey Cup week to pick up an award.
Yeah, the league's most outstanding defensive player a year ago. For a long time, this has been one of the best defensive players in the league. Nice to see him finally recognized. A career season for Chip Cox. Career highs in tackles, sacks, and matching his career high in interceptions. You get a feel for what a versatile defender he is.
Bo Mitchell, little hitch screen out to Brad Sinopoli on the far side. Chip Cox, only the second Montreal Alouette in their long history to ever win Most Outstanding Defensive Player, the other Anwar Stewart back in 2004.
Yeah, former teammate Anwar Stewart, now a member of the Alouettes coaching staff. You talk about Chip Cox, you know, I know we mentioned in the preseason, Corey Banks is the only player on the list of active top 10 to be in the top 10 active players in terms of tackles, sacks, and interceptions. Chip Cox, just a couple sacks away from joining him in that exclusive company.
Mitchell over the top and almost hauled in. Anthony Parker downfield, one of the many Calgary Dinos in this ball game. In fact, one of the many University of Calgary Dinos in the CFL. Almost, that would have been a big gainer. So the Stamps will kick it away again.
Bullet dodged there for the Montreal Alouettes, who have been holding their own against that Calgary offense, which has been working with the wind here in the third.
Looking for one big play. Larry Taylor tackled near his 37. It's 14-0. Hometown Stamps over the Owls. Yours today. Welcome back to McMahon Stadium in Calgary on a blustery yet sunny day. Big wind here today. Troy Smith against that wind. Crossing pattern to Deron Carter. Rod Black, Dwayne Ford, Jermaine Franklin with you and our entire crew as the CFL season kicks off this week. Second game of the regular season. Winnipeg winning at home on Thursday night against the Toronto Argonauts. Edmonton and BC after this, and tomorrow we'll be out Mosaic Stadium for the rematch of the Grey Cup game, Hamilton and Saskatchewan.
A rematch of last year's game, but two very different teams based on off-season activity. You see Deron Carter hobble off the field after that last reception.
Second and 7. Smith, quick drop and a drop as well by Brandon Whitaker, who has not even been part of the offense since early in this ball game.
Whitaker again had a couple of good runs early on. You'd think the run game would be a critical part of what the Montreal Alouettes try to do offensively here, but very quickly left behind for a passing game that hasn't been able to gain much traction here.
Third 2-and-out forced by the Calgary Stampeders. Pretty good kick into the breeze by White. Sanders, and a penalty flag up near the midfield stripe. Holding against the Stampeders will push them back even further as we're past the midway point in this third quarter. Bo Mitchell brings his offense back on the field, the native of Katy, Texas.
Holding.
Trying to find the end zone again, something he did last play of the first quarter here at McMahon. There he is, Bo Mitchell in the huddle. 24-year-old, 6'2" quarterback out of Katy, Texas. Katy, Texas, known for the Friday night lights.
There you see Bo Levi Mitchell back in 2007, leading Katy to the state championship, an undefeated season. This is stuff legends are made of.
Such a difference between the two Texans, Drew Tate and Bo Levi Mitchell, style and personality. One's fire, one's ice. Both can lead teams. Here's the Iceman, Bo Levi Mitchell. Goes over the top, and there's Nick Lewis. Welcome back, Nick. The comeback is complete. Broke his fibula last season.
Well, it's a little bit different role for Nick Lewis this season, a guy who's been a perennial 1,000-yard receiver. In fact, over 1,000 yards in each of his first 9 seasons in the league. Last year was year 10 when he got injured.
John Cornish, right side. This was the injury to Nick Lewis last year.
Suffered,
it was devastating.
Suffered in the 7th game of the season playing against the BC Lions. That leg rolled up awkwardly as he was tackled.
Stopped his streak of 9 straight 1,000-yard seasons. You could see the pain, not only physically but mentally, for Nick Lewis. Said it was tough to come back, but there was no doubt that he would be coming back. And that continues his streak, by the way. 165 straight games with at least a catch. Mitchell now for Sinopoli. An overthrow. But it is so good to have Nick Lewis back.
Never. I think my parents were more worried than I was. Never thought about that being my last play. I never thought about not coming back. I think I actually thought it would be easier to come back, and it actually has been a little harder than I thought it really was. But it gave me a reason to wake up every morning just to get a little bit better every day. It gave me something to fight for.
Booming punt again from Rob Maver, another long one, 88 yards, and another single, 15-0. So Nick Lewis, though, continues his streak, 165. CFL record is 216. That's not even on his mind. He just wanted to get back, being with his team, and contributing again. One of the most colorful characters in many ways. He has been the Chad Johnson of the CFL North the last few years.
Yeah, well, ironically, very similar numbers between the two of them over their course of their careers on different sides of the border. Nick Lewis just under 11,000 yards receiving for his career. Chad Johnson just over 11,000. And Nick Lewis now finds himself, at least to start the season, as a designated international, formerly designated import on this Calgary Stampeder roster. So he's not an every down player, but he's still going to get his touches.
Just over 4 minutes to go in the third quarter. Brandon Whitaker gets another touch. And here's another guy battling back from injuries. We talked about the knee, the hamstring last year. This is certainly, though, a different look. We saw it last year when Anthony Calvillo went down. You knew the era was going to change at some point, that AC couldn't play forever, and they got a dose of that last year. The Alouettes still made it to the playoffs after Calvillo missed 10 games with a concussion and ultimately retired. But now they have to find a way offensively, and this clearly is the guy to do it, Troy Smith.
Yeah, it's going to take some time, and obviously adding to that transition period, a change of offensive coordinators, during training camp with Rick Warman relieved of his duties. Ryan Dinwiddie, the former Winnipeg Blue Bomber quarterback, takes over, being supported as well by offensive line coach Chris Sweet. And it's going to take some time for those guys to get to know what Troy Smith's comfort zone is. And quite frankly, for Troy Smith, as a guy who hasn't spent a lot of time in the Canadian Football League, for him to get to know what his own comfort zone is within this league, what things he does well, what things he doesn't do so well. And over time, they'll be able to better put him in a position to be successful.
He's had some brief flashes last year, and even in this game, that last snag by Eric Delorier. Now to the far side, penalty flag as Chad Johnson tries to lay out an incomplete pass, but there is a flag back at the 49-yard line. Might be a jump by the receivers, and it was offside against Montreal. Such a season of turmoil for the Alouettes, though, at the beginning of last season. Forget the Calvillo injury.
Procedure, Montreal, illegal formation, penalties declined, second down.
You had a sense of the new era in Montreal when Dan Hawkins was hired as their coach, taking over from Mark Trestman. Short-lived tenure as head coach of the Alouettes.
Yeah, lasting less than half a season, and obviously that was represented a 180-degree turn for the players in terms of the culture. I don't think that in terms of personality and style, Mark Trestman and Dan Hawkins could have been any more different.
Second and 10, Smith hangs in. Catch made near the midfield stripe by S.J. Green. Well, Hawkins was relieved, of course, by general manager Jim Popp in the offseason. Owner Robert Wettenhall, in fact, contacted Tom Higgins and hired Tom Higgins to be the new coach of the Alouettes.
And Tom Higgins, an experienced CFL coach, in fact, began his career right here in Calgary. He and John Huffnagel won a Grey Cup together as assistant coaches here in Calgary back in 1992, former coach of the year in Edmonton a couple years later.
He is one of the most positive men you will ever meet in your life,
yes.
Tom Higgins.
As straight a shooter as there is.
Said today would be serendipitous in some ways. And he was emotional when we talked to him yesterday about being a coach again in the league and the fact that his wife is here in the crowd today, Sharon, and they're celebrating their 34th wedding anniversary. Where else would you celebrate it at a football stadium?
Well, very fitting for someone who's made football part of his life, part of his family's life for so many years.
So it will be third and one. 2:13 to go, third quarter. The Owls need to put some points on the board. No one has scored going in this direction today against the wind. He hands it off. Dangerous play. I'm not sure he got there. Looks like with this spot, it's going to be a first down. And it's all about the spot here. Had to get just over the midfield stripe. You can see the yard marker on the other side. Right there is the push by Whitaker. So should be a first down. There's a penalty flag, though, back at the 48-yard line.
Yeah, that flag was thrown well after the play. Probably in the pushing and shoving in the pile. Somebody may have taken a 15-yarder here.
The ruling on the field is a first down. We have a major foul, unnecessary roughness. Calgary, 15 yards to the end of the play, first down.
Yet another undisciplined 15-yarder against the Calgary Stampeders, and that is not going to bode well with head coach John Huffnagel.
Well, this is how we saw the game open defensively for the Calgary Stampeders after a 15-yard penalty. Keep an eye on the bottom corner of your screen here. A bit of pushing and shoving between Jeff Parrott and DeQuinn Evans.
Well, something happened down there. Parrott was on top of Evans. The official was right there. Once again, the give up the gut in traffic to Brandon Whitaker. Half the first down yardage, it looks like. Keep establishing the ground here against the wind and hope for the best with it in the fourth. See if they can put some points on the board.
Well, what the Alouettes just did on first down is exactly what you need to see more consistently from this offense. Whitaker with the ball in his hands, high percentage plays, positive yards on first down that get them into situations where they've got the option to run or pass on second down.
Look out, Smith buried again. The fourth sack by the ransacking Calgary Stampeders.
Some costly yardage again lost on that sack as well.
This one, it looked like they might have been close to field goal position again against this Gale. Well out of it now, and Sean White is going to have to angle the kick again with 32 to go before the end of the third.
It was Juwan Simpson, the middle linebacker, coming on that blitz. Brandon Whitaker, the running back, was a little bit late getting over to him.
Alouette still in it as White puts it into the end zone. And Montreal is finally going to get a point on the board. Now down two converted touchdowns. Here's our sack attack brought to you by Purolator. Tackling hunger across Canada, check. These are last year's numbers. Calgary 63 led the CFL in sack totals, and Montreal was close behind.
Well, Montreal had that active defense where those sacks were spread among a number of players. Chip Cox, most notably, though, had 12, and of course, Calgary.
Objectional conduct, Montreal, number 47, 10-yard penalty, first down.
Calgary led by the bookends a year ago, Charleston Hughes, and the since-departed Cordero Law, who's moved on to an NFL shot, both among the league leaders.
Javon Webb is the guilty party on that last penalty. 10 yards gained after a touchback by the Stampeders. So 15-1 is the score. Should be close to the final play here. And then the Alouettes will have the win. And a lot of work to do. They have not been in sync offensively from the get-go. Mitchell. Simon Charbonneau-Campo could go. Brought down at the 30-yard line.
The former Sherbrooke star picked up in an offseason trade from the Hamilton Tiger Cats. Makes his first catch as a Calgary Stampeder. Turns it into a big one.
35-yarder. Time to trade sides. Trade the wind advantage. 15-1 Calgary. Both quarterbacks operating around 50% throwing in this game. 15-1 Stampeders, a quarter away, 15 minutes away from picking up win number one after a 14-4 season last year. Possibility of win number one in 2014. Great day to fly a kite, not such a good day to throw a football.
No, kind of tough, and with the running backs being held in check, whether it's been by play calling or by defensive effort, as you saw the Montreal defense doing a pretty good job on John Cornish here so far. Quarterbacks being forced to put the ball in the air in far from ideal situation. Now you see Calgary holding a huge advantage coming into the fourth quarter in terms of yardage in this ball game, but the Montreal Alouettes very much in striking distance with 15 minutes to go.
Alouettes defense continuing to do what they did last year and keep them in football games. Trying to limit the Stampeders again here, perhaps to a field goal attempt or even push them out of field goal position. First and 10 from the 30.
Great call.
And a great direct snap to John Cornish. Cornish's numbers a little bit down compared to last year's season opener, but he'll take it right now. His team's leading.
I'm finding a different way to get the ball into John Cornish's hands. He's lined up beside quarterback Bo Mitchell. Direct snap to the running back creates a little bit of misdirection. Allows Cornish to get a jump start on the defense and trying to get to the perimeter on the right side. It's a nice call from the OC, Dave Dickinson.
John Cornish, who a season like Russ Jackson did so many years ago, though Jackson was a quarterback, by winning the most outstanding player in the Canadian Football League. And for those viewers in the United States, for so many years, Americans or internationals, import players, have led rushing titles or won rushing crowns. It's been a change of culture, a bit of a shift up here, and mostly due to a guy like John Cornish.
Yeah, John Cornish, Andrew Harris, you go back a couple of years. Jerome Messam named the league's most outstanding Canadian after a terrific year carrying the football as a starting running back.
Jeff Fuller back in the game now. Second and inches. Drew Tate in as the first down. Not only was the most outstanding player in the CFL, he was the most outstanding athlete in Canada last year. Won the Lou Marsh Trophy Award. He's chasing legends.
You see those career yardage totals? 32 yards behind Jack Parker.
Not out of the realm of possibility with what he can do in streaks. He's a streaky runner. He can go five or six games, 100 yard plus games, close to 200. There's another direct snap to Cornish. Cornish, left side, and he'll score his first touchdown of the season. On cue, John Cornish, 18-yard touchdown.
Quick attack to the outside. Again, Cornish just to the right of his quarterback. Watch the job the offensive line does of getting out in front of John Cornish. Bo Levi Mitchell's going to try and hold the backside end. See the big boys get out front. The rookie Brander Craighead helps seal things off to the inside. Cornish gets in untouched. Nice execution there from the Stampeder offense.
Had a season he had last year. Wouldn't it be something if he could win another crown, make it three in a row rushing titles, and also maybe even threaten that magical mark of 2,000 yards? Who knows? It's game one, though. He's got touchdown number one. Had 12 rushing touchdowns a season ago. This time, the direct snap to perfection. The Stamps are rolling. Four-play, 65-yard drive, capped off by John Cornish, last year's most outstanding player. Finds pay dirt again.
There you see Bo Levi Mitchell. He backs out of there. His job's to hold that backside end. Everybody else getting a body on a body, whether it's receivers, like Nick Lewis right in the middle of your screen on Billy Parker, the offensive line. Again, great execution by all 12 guys to make that play successful.
So the hole gets deeper as the ball falls off the tee here in the wind. The hole gets deeper for the Montreal Alouettes, now down three converted touchdowns here, 21 points in the fourth. They'll have the benefit of the breeze, but a long way to go. Particularly, they haven't had any kind of continuity offensively.
Yeah, you look at the Montreal Alouettes at this stage of the ball game, 141 yards in offense through three quarters.
Good kick into the wind. Taylor, can he get a spark? Nope. Brought down at the 24. Still the Troy Smith show here.
And the fact remains, Troy Smith is going to need to get reps and need to get experience here in the Canadian Football League. A couple of starts late last season. But now this is his first opportunity to go through a Canadian Football League training camp and be with this team right from the start, develop a little bit of a rapport with his receivers and so on. But it all takes time. It's a short training camp up here, just two preseason games, and he was injured for the first one.
A wonky knee, Daron Carter, a little bit of a rub play on the far side. He's bounced out of bounds by Daron Mayo. For the season, they throw a flag over there now. Right at the Alouettes sideline. So that might have been part of what happened after that play. Daron Carter and Daron Mayo were into it.
Late shove here by Mayo.
10-yard penalty, first down.
It goes against the Alouettes, so that play is negated.
Carter, the outside receiver here, just a quick hitch. He gets his two blockers out in front. Tries to make something happen. The hand up in the face with the face mask there, but the toss of the ball back at the defender at the end of the play.
Give Carter the catch, but penalty moves them back 10. Smith, and high in the air, leaping for it. Unable to hang on is Kenny Stafford, who, by the way, is a first cousin of Daron Carter. In fact, worked off in the offseason with Daron and his dad, Chris, the Pro Football Hall of Famer. Of course, works with ESPN. getting ready for this new season. Out of Toledo. Again, we saw Jamel Richardson here. I'm not sure if he's still around, but it's very interesting to note that Jamel Richardson, who Calgary Stampeders, when asked yesterday if they're interested in the former Alouettes receiver, said no. Yet today, Jamel Richardson was wearing Calgary Stampeder gear.
Yeah, Jamel Richardson went through some medical tests conducted by the Calgary Stampeders yesterday. Everybody trying to figure out where the knee that he injured last season is at. It appears for the time being, though, he is not signed, although it's, and there's Jay Rich.
You can always support.
Well, you know, I think that his support may have as much to do with the way he left the Alouettes as it has to do with the possibility of him perhaps becoming a Calgary Stampeder once that knee is fully recuperated.
One of the great Alouette receivers over the last few years, then released suddenly, and of course the injury last year, and then failed a medical in Toronto, now here. So we'll see what gives with Jamel Richardson over the next couple of days. We have a penalty flag. This is the eighth straight
violation.
Punt.
Montreal number six
for the Alouettes.
5-yard penalty.
Sean White had to take a time count violation here. Last 10 possessions, Dwayne, 9 punts and a pick.
Last season, the big issue for the Montreal Alouettes, obviously their defense was holding them in games and did a terrific job in terms of creating takeaways. The problem was that offensively, particularly with Calvillo out for a stretch, was that there were too many giveaways. They had a lot of turnovers offensively, particularly a lot of interceptions thrown by their collection of young quarterbacks. So far today, it hasn't been a matter of turnovers, but just lack of continuity, lack of production from their offense.
Oh boy, that was not a good play by Jock Sanders.
A horrible decision.
And there's a penalty flag on a huge kick by Sean White. Sanders should have given up one. A 90-yard kick in the wind.
Coming up, Calgary's former number one quarterback Kevin Glenn makes his Lions debut in place of the injured Travis Lule against the Edmonton Eskimos. Part two of our doubleheader. Back to Rod and Dwayne.
Thank you so much, Rod.
22-1. Previous kick. We have an illegal block. Number 87. Well, the ball is in goal. The penalty is declined. First down.
So a bad decision and a penalty by Jock Sanders. Clearly should have given up the single point. So the Stampeders now, against this stiff wind, have a long field.
Yeah, this is an opportunity for the Montreal Alouettes at defense. It was terrific in terms of generating those takeaways last year.
There's John Cornish out of the hole again. Past the 10-yard line, up near the 15. You mentioned the takeaways. The Alouettes last season were first in takeaways in the CFL, seventh in giveaways.
As you see, Nick Lewis lined up as a tight end on that play. Had a great kickout block right at the point of attack, making a contribution even when he's not catching the football.
Well, that makes this offense breathe a lot easier. Comfortable lead now for Bo Mitchell, trying to get his first win. There's Fuller, injured earlier in the game. Now a straight arm and another Jeff Fuller. You're an NFL fan, you know that name, Jeff Fuller. His dad played with the 49ers, a free safety, and suffered a spinal cord injury back in 1989 against New England and left him partially paralyzed. Jeff Fuller was a terrific, terrific ball player. Free safety for the Niners, and his son now in the Canadian Football League.
Nick Lewis, who has earned a reputation as one of the most fierce blockers in the Canadian Football League, particularly among receivers. Just had a couple of blocks on this play. Keep an eye on Lewis. Here's number 82, and he has got the radar on right here. Ear hole shot on Marco Briette,
who is down on the turf. What a block. There's where the similarity between he and Chad Johnson ends. Nick Lewis, who, by the way, when he was in high school, was a quarterback and a defensive end. Nick Lewis.
It fits. Nick Lewis at about 6 feet and 240 pounds, built like a fullback, but has been a perennial 1,000-yard receiver in this league.
Guy, again, a huge personality like Chad Johnson. A guy, who, you know, though, yesterday when we had a chance to sit down with him and talk with him, he says how quiet he is back home in Jacksboro, Texas.
Watch the right side of your screen. Here he'll come from the left.
That was a thunderous hit.
Earlier on that play, there have been concerns for a lot of people knowing Nick Lewis's personality and the fact that he has never been one to withhold his opinions. Some concerns with him taking on a smaller role this year. But we've seen him do some little things in this ball game. He was actually the guy that had the rub at the start of that play to free up Jeff Fuller. So willing to contribute, to do things to help out his team. And here you see active sportsmanship as he comes over to check on Briette and make sure that his opponent is all right.
That says a lot about Nick Lewis, by the way, and Marc-Olivier Briette. That's a great sign that he's up. Looks like he's okay, but gregarious Nick Lewis, who Chad Johnson has Ocho Cinco, but Nick Lewis has a lot of his different handles he's had through the years. Geronimo, and he just makes them up. Said he was really looking forward to seeing Chad Johnson today, too. He said that having number 85 here in Canada just makes the game and helps spread the faith down south, and people can realize it. You know, the talent base in the CFL is perhaps a lot more than they might have thought if they were just looking in for the first time. Chad Johnson, not the first to come from the NFL, and won't be the last. After that big block and the game by Fuller. Oh, what a floater! Cornish still on his feet, rumbles up, and John Cornish was hit hard in the head. And there's another penalty flag against Montreal.
Well, basically clothesline there by Kyrus Hebert.
So
I could see this one escalating in a hurry.
Especially a team that is down by three touchdowns. Cornish just got hammered at clothesline by Kyrus Hebert, who again is one of the most fierce players in the Canadian Football League. A guy who was also a huge hitter. Now they're jawing back and forth. Let's take another look at this. Watch this float pass, though. A little teardrop against the wind.
Yeah, John Bowman forced him to do that. The defensive end recognized what was coming and didn't rush.
Oh, boy. That is a vicious, vicious swipe.
Yeah, big-time headshot here. Coming over the top with the right arm.
And John Cornish looked like he might have been out when he got hit like that. This is not a good sign here. John Cornish, see his neck get jarred as well. And now the ambulance has actually come on the field here. What a terrible turn of events here. John Cornish, last year's most outstanding player, is going to be taken away in an ambulance. Seems to be some movement. That's a good sign there.
Yeah, you can see the hands moving. Cornish down there.
Major
talking,
foul.
Communicating.
Rough play. Disqualification. Montreal, number 34. 25-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
So the kind of hits that could lead to some disciplinary action from the league as well.
And that's a good job by the referee, Kim Murphy, taking control of the situation. It's the right call, but it also, by getting Hebert out of the game, I think limits the opportunity for this to escalate into a little bit of a Pier 6 brawl.
Again, he took it to the side of the head, but you can see his neck jar awkwardly. So back-to-back plays, we have injured players. First, Marc-Olivier Briette, and now John Cornish. As this game has got very chippy all of a sudden, we'll step aside and come back with John Cornish on the field at McMahon Stadium. Here is a very good sign. John Cornish is up. He does not have to leave the field in the ambulance. He is going to the locker room.
Yeah, I think John Cornish took one peek over at the ambulance. He said, I'll leave the game, but I'm not leaving in that thing.
So looks dazed. He says, I'm okay. But boy, he took a shot from Kyra Saber, who just took some boos from fans here at McMahon Stadium as he was ejected from this game. Likely will face some disciplinary action after that vicious blow. So after all of this, Calgary has the ball. First and 10 at the Montreal 32-yard line. Leading by 21. Slant pattern, quick one. Sinopoli again, another catch. Brad Sinopoli actually had one of his breakout games last year against the Montreal Alouettes. A guy who some people felt could make it as a quarterback in this league, but instead, back and such a terrific athlete, became a receiver and became a good receiver.
Yeah, it was his first start at receiver last year, came against Montreal and posted season highs with 5 receptions, 81 yards in that ball game. Former Heck Crichton Trophy winner as the top university football player in Canada.
Pounding the ball up the middle is another one of those former Dinos, Matt Walter. Lake Nill, the head coach here, University of Calgary, came from St. Mary's University in Halifax, and both programs helped develop so many great young players. And there are 8 of them in the game today that are traced back to Lake Nill's recruitment.
And that's just in this game, because they're all across this league. Lake Nill done a tremendous job developing players for the pro ranks.
Cole Mitchell hands off to the former Dino again, Matt Walter. You mentioned those Dinos in the league, and here are some of them who are in the game today, including Stephen Lamballe for Montreal, and Dave Stalla played at St. Mary's, of course. There they all are with Blake, the guy who helped found them and taught them well.
Yeah, he sure has. Tremendous recruiter, outstanding coach.
Mike Edom in there.
Yeah, Edom now in the game at free safety with Marco Briette out. Sophomore, 3rd overall pick last year, coming off a terrific rookie season.
Tremendous program here at the University of Calgary. Been perennial contender since Blake came west. John Bowman limps to the sidelines.
That UFC program, even with one in the NFL right now. Lyndon Gaidosh, the number 1 overall pick in last year's CFL draft, selected by the Hamilton Tiger Cats.
Well, maybe it wasn't such a bad decision to stay in the end zone by Jock Sanders after all. Look what's happened.
Well,
after
it's worked out.
It's worked out, but I think he won't be doing that again, let's put it that way.
No.
Under John Huffnagel. Look at this. It started at their own 2. 6 plays, 91 yards later, the Stampeders threatening to score again. Play action, ball, end zone, touchdown! And there is one of those former Calgary Dinos, Anthony Parker.
Strike from Bo Levi Mitchell to Anthony Parker, the number 3 overall pick in the 2011 draft. Parker has started to see a little bit more action over the last 2 years. Finds himself wide open in the end zone.
Parker, who went a while without any touchdowns with the Calgary Stampeders, kind of spot duty, has been inserted, getting a lot of playing time at 2 major scores last year, and has his first of 2014. Bo Levi Mitchell at his first start of 2014, the season opener, over 300 yards passing now. Calgary Stampeders are tanking it now to the Alouettes.
And Anthony Parker lines up on the outside. They're going to free him up from that corner by bringing a route out into the flat. Watch the corner step down on that route. Halfback also collapsing on that route in the flat. Nobody goes with Anthony Parker to deep to the corner.
So looking good now for the Stampeders. Got off to a slow start in this game. Led 4-0. Late first quarter, then Bo Mitchell found Maurice Price, 102-yard touchdown, and even since halftime, with the wind, against the wind, it doesn't matter. It's been all Stampeders.
And there you heard it, Anthony Parker, former All-Canadian at the University of Calgary. He's been in that end zone before. The University of Calgary Dinos play their home games right here at McMahon Stadium as well.
Yeah, these guys haven't had to go far, had they, when they got drafted and came to Calgary. They knew this stadium well. 7-play, 108-yard drive, engineered by Bo Mitchell. And it was a very eventful drive, though, in real time. Practically took about 15, 20 minutes with all the injuries. Larry Taylor can't scoot outside. Let's go to the sideline now and get an update on the injury. Here's Jermaine Franklin.
Rod, while John Cornish was being escorted off the field, Rich Stuber gathered his defense around, and the message that he gave his players was of composure. No ticky-tack fouls, no selfish plays, no revenge. It's about the white horse. Play with composure and within the rules.
There is the defensive guru. Thank you, Jermaine. Rich Stubler comes to Calgary. He's coached almost every team in this league. And, of course, Rick Campbell left Calgary, defensive coordinator, now is the head coach of the Ottawa Redblacks. You could not find a better replacement than this guy.
No, you sure couldn't. One of the most experienced coaches in this league. Longtime defensive coordinator of the Toronto Argonauts. Won a Grey Cup with them in 2004. He's been with the BC Lions in recent years, the Edmonton Eskimos. Now here in Calgary. Pretty good start for his defense. Just 1 point allowed here thus far in their debut under Stubler.
Well, he has the admiration and respect of the sack man on the Calgary D-line, Charleston Hughes.
Mainly just telling me to go do what I do best. I mean, he pretty much expresses that to everybody on the defense, is to let everybody just make plays and be reckless on the field. He's an awesome coach. It's the first time I've ever played for a coach like that before, and you know what, it's different, and I like it.
Charleston Hughes has a sack in this game. 4 sacks for Calgary, led the CFL last season.
It'll be a little bit different for Charleston Hughes, no doubt, but don't anticipate his production dropping off at all. Last year, they moved him around a little bit more, putting him in positions to get after the quarterback, trying to free him up. It'll be a little more traditional route.
Ooh, that might have been a pick six if that had been caught.
That's the newcomer on the corner, number 38, Buddy Jackson.
His first game with the Calgary Stampeders, Pittsburgh University. Actual name is Anthony Hugh Jackson, but when he was growing up, his parents had a Buddy doll, and next thing you know, you carry a name for the rest of your life. He's Buddy. Buddy almost had a touchdown in his first pick. Second and 10. Alouettes need a bunch. Troy Smith, look at this arm, but a big overthrow. Talked about the strong arm. We've seen the strong arm too much, but I think Tom Higgins is going to have a chat, or Ryan Dinwiddie is going to have a chat with Troy Smith. It's about tapering that arm off a little bit. We've clearly seen Troy Smith has overthrown so many receivers today.
Yeah, and it's been this week. We saw it last week in that preseason finale as well. Got to develop that touch to go along with the strength of that arm. I think the other thing you'll see from this Montreal offense as the season goes on, they start to taper things a little bit.
And there's another penalty, Alouettes. We'll get the ball back again.
Lynn J. Shell is arguing that he was blocked into the kicker.
Jock Sanders still on his feet. That's twice now that Sean White has been pasted as he punted the ball. Stampeders, by the way, have a bye week next week again.
Contact any kicker. Calgary, 10-yard penalty. First down.
With the nine teams now, with Ottawa coming in, will be a bye team every week, and Calgary's next game will be in Toronto, July 12th. Alouettes will try to regroup. They have BC on July 4th.
Well, the Alouettes catch a bit of a break on that one as Lynn J. Shell was blocked late. The deep back personal protector for the kicker. Andrew Liu reacted late. Bumped Shell into the punter, Sean White.
NHL draft was held last night. Aaron Ekblad, number one. The free agent market opens up on Tuesday. We have you covered all day, beginning at 11:30 a.m. Eastern, 8:30 a.m. Pacific on TSN. Which big names will be on the move and which ones will stay put? Find out NHL free agent frenzy Tuesday on TSN. Canada Day, of course. Red and white across the nation that day. And free agent day. National Hockey League. Well, the Alouettes know that there'll be an L beside them for their first one here. 14-4 the last 18 seasons in season openers. They're not getting one in Calgary. They want to get something going here. Ron Carter can't haul that in. And a penalty flag again. More nylon on the field over at the 35-yard line.
This one's going to go against the Montreal Alouettes.
Holding, Montreal, number 59. 10-yard penalty, remains first down.
Well, Tom Higgins knew this would not be an easy task coming in, creating a different culture and a new era in the Alouette organization.
See the holding call against left tackle Josh Burt.
Those penalties have piled up for the Alouettes. In this game, they were worst in the CFL last year, and another high toss for Duron Carter. Alouettes had more penalties than anyone in the CFL last season. Another area that has to be cleaned up, clearly.
Now, there are some parts in place, clearly, for the Montreal Alouettes. We've talked a lot about the receiving corps. With S.J. Green, second leading receiver in the CFL last season. Duron Carter joined the lineup partway through the year and was among the league leaders in terms of receiving yardage per game. Obviously, the arrival of Chad Johnson this season. You've got Brandon Whitaker in that backfield. Now, the offensive line had to replace two starters at midseason last year at guard.
Troy Smith fires and coming back. A flag on the play. Flew on the Calgary sideline. Incomplete pass. Troy Smith had some running room that time, too, if he wanted to take it, but it was second and 20. Might have been afforded that time because of a hold.
Illegal participation, Montreal, number two. The penalty is declined.
Brandon Whitaker went out of bounds and came back in, hence the illegal participation. It's all gone wrong for the Alouettes here in the second half.
Start to see a little bit of substituting from the Calgary defense on that possession. Wouldn't surprise to see the same thing start to happen offensively. I think we'll see Drew Tate enter the game for Calgary here at quarterback in their next possession.
Sanders stopped in his tracks near the 48. 4:42 to go. So the other Texan comes into the game now. Here's Drew Tate. What an afternoon for Bo Levi Mitchell in his first season opening start. And Bo Mitchell is perfect as a starter. 3-0 last year. This will make it 4-0 as a starter with the Calgary Stampeders.
Yeah, and good to see Drew Tate get an opportunity to get in the feel of this ball game as well. Guy who, as John Huffnagel alluded to earlier, they got wins from three different guys last year, and you have the feeling that they'll get contributions from more than one QB this time out.
Matt Walter bursts right side. Bo Mitchell said that he was jacked to play today. Friends and family watching down south, getting the season opening starts, as it's a business. He understood both he and Drew Tate, they're good buddies. He said Drew was very supportive of the decision to give Bo the job as the starter right now. And he looked good. And despite a bit of a shaky start for Bo Mitchell, I mean, again, both teams a little rusty out of the gate, and the wind was clearly affecting the ball.
Well, again, the Canadian Football League, the preseason is just two games. And the starters definitely don't play a lot in the first one, rarely even play more than a half in the second one. So through the first month of the season, you can almost call it extended training camp, because a lot of guys are still getting used to each other. Very difficult for a team to come out hitting on all cylinders in any phase of the game.
This is a team that through the years, you played in this organization, Dwayne, this is a team that has had a few quarterback question marks, not because of a lack of talent, but often the luxury of a lot of talent.
Yeah, no question. I was fortunate enough to play here at a time when, you know, and this was right on the heels of Doug Flutie being here. Doug Flutie and Jeff Garcia were teammates here. While Garcia was here, Dave Dickinson and Henry Burris both joined the organization. Those three guys were all here together.
Goes back to the days of Wally Buono, and of course Wally, guy who can find quarterbacks, diamonds in the rough too, and did through the years, and it's continued here in Calgary. Drew Tate will finish this one out. 3-minute warning on the field, 3 minutes from win number one. Love their home cooking here. This is a team under John Huffnagel through the years that plays so well at McMahon Stadium. Chalk up another one here, 3 minutes away from their first win of 2014. Drew Tate, Jock Sanders under cover. Minimal gain.
Sanders, former star at the University of West Virginia, signed as a free agent from the Grey Cup champion Saskatchewan Roughriders in the offseason. His primary role here will be to replace Larry Taylor in that return game, but also a guy who gives them a little bit more depth in that backfield behind John Cornish. Could also play the slot, as he did occasionally in Saskatchewan if needed there.
Been a winning era here for John Huffnagel and the Stampeders since 1981. And when Huff took over in 08, Stamps, when they win their season opener, of the eight times they've made it to the Grey Cup game, they've won the season opener. So on their way to another season opening win here. Let's go down to the sideline again. Here's Jermaine.
Hey guys, well Rod, you know, this isn't the first time that Troy Smith and Drew Tate have faced each other. They faced each other in the NCAAs three times. Drew Tate with Iowa won the first meeting. Troy Smith won the last two. However, Smith did say in that conference that he learned a lot from Drew Tate, especially when it comes to the scrambling ability and the ability to extend plays. So they face each other once again, this time in the CFL.
In the CFL, but at a time in the game when Troy Smith's just still trying to get something on the board. There's been a lot of that today, Kenny Stafford, and Drew Tate is mopping up. It's because Bo Levi Mitchell threw for over 300 today and sparked his team to win number one. Talked about the home field advantage here under Huffnagel since he took over, Dwayne. at McMahon Stadium, the Stamps, with this win, will be 41-13-1. That's a remarkable record.
Yeah, there's no place like home. Great atmosphere here at McMahon. No question.
Last 2 minutes now. Here come the Stamps again. Another ferocious rush. They are not taking it easy on Troy Smith one bit. Charleston Hughes again has had a monster day. Right Hughes. In on him.
Yeah, from the bottom of your screen. Stephen Lombala got to him with the cut block. Another of the former Dinos. Lombala got some reps at fullback for the Owls this season.
Don't forget, right after this, we're going to send you to BC Place. The Lions, former Stamp quarterback, Kevin Glenn. The Lions now against the Edmonton Eskimos and Mike Riley. Right after this, Sanders. He's got an opening and another. Jock Sanders taking over the same number, as a matter of fact, of Larry Taylor. He brings it up near the 46-yard line. That's coming up next. There's Adam Big Hill and the BC Lions. Mike Riley and the Edmonton Eskimos. New head coach Chris Jones to revitalize the Eskimos' fortunes in the five-team West this season, with Winnipeg moving over, of course, and Ottawa coming into the league once again. Red Blacks have the bye in the first week. They'll get going next week. For Tate again. Seems to be a very satisfying win for the Calgary Stampeders. A lingering bad taste in their mouth after their loss in the West Final last year. They went into that West Final after some key injuries defensively as well, in a game late in the season that proved to be very costly to their fortunes.
Yeah, well, it's regardless of who you're facing, it's going to be tough to defend the run when you lose a couple of key defensive players, defensive linemen, going into a game like that, and particularly facing the Saskatchewan Rough Riders with that tremendous offensive line. Obviously, Corey Sheets and the season he had last year before moving on to join the NFL's Raiders this year.
Kept the dream season alive for the Saskatchewan Rough Riders, who we'll see tomorrow against Hamilton. Riders came to McMahon, won, and then won the 101st Grey Cup. Last three seasons, team hosting the Grey Cup has won the Grey Cup. It had been a long drought in between that. So does that mean advantage BC this year?
Time will tell.
They host the 102nd Grey Cup. Last minute now, out of bounds. Great day offensively for this young man. Not so much for the Alouettes. Just 1 point.
Well, for the Montreal Alouettes, it's going to be very important. Get back to Montreal. Watch the film of this one. Take what positives they can, correct the mistakes, and get ready to wheel back into the battle zone next week.
Two teams that used to regularly meet, rivals, Grey Cup games, as a matter of fact. Eric DeLaurier. Looks up about five or six on that toss.
DeLaurier, longtime Montreal Alouette. Eastern Michigan University.
Alouettes have not been on Calgary's side of the field much today. Furthest they got downfield was the 23. There's Kenny Stafford. Hard hit on the far side. Jamar Wall. The Wall. But it is a first down for Montreal. Moving the football a little bit late now, but just did not get it going. Credit the Calgary defense too. Bad snap here. Smith hangs in, and again another overthrow. Troy Smith has demonstrated that strong arm many times today, but there's been nothing but air at the other end.
Again, there's a need here for the Montreal Alouettes to continue to adjust offensively. You know, it's not just a matter of the production, but they've got to get Smith into situations that allow him to be successful. They're committed to this guy as their quarterback of the future. And you've got to build the offense around the things that he's comfortable doing, things that he does well.
We remember last year when we first saw Troy Smith, and we chatted for a long time with Jim Popp when Troy Smith was the third guy behind Josh Nicewander and also Tanner Marsh and Anthony Calvillo, who was already out. And Jim Popp at the time said, hey, we're going to bring this guy along slowly. Might be painful for a while. And now he's been thrust into the helm. But it's his show.
Yeah, it became clear, I think, by the end of last season that Troy Smith was the best option for the Montreal Alouettes going forward and relative to the other young quarterbacks.
Wide open is Dave Stalla. Started his career in Montreal, some great years, seasons with Hamilton, now back in Montreal. Flags downfield, and looks like it might be against Calgary. 27-yard pickup on that first reception of 2014 for Dave Stalla.
Major foul, roughing the passer. Calgary, number 40. 15 yards to be added to the play. First down.
It might be the old adage, too, though, Dwayne. It doesn't matter what you've done. Remember that as we see the penalty here. Yeah, Troy Smith's played a lot. Yeah, he won the Heisman Trophy. Yeah, he went to the NFL. But he hasn't played much in the last few years. And you just need time before things start to slow down.
Yeah, you need playing time as a whole. But in particular, I'm a firm believer that at any position, you need playing time in this league.
Yeah.
There are enough nuances, enough differences between American and Canadian football that there's going to be a learning curve for anybody making the switch.
Oh, and he got rocked again, and another penalty.
S.J. Green, the intended receiver.
Best offense for the Alouettes so far in drives has been penalties
Major
by the
foul,
Calgary Stampeders.
Calgary, number 91. 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
To Quinn Evans, another 15-yarder, but these 15-yarders haven't hurt the Stampeders. Six 15-yard major penalties today, but the Alouettes still have yet to score a major. There's something for Calgary to clean up and shore up as well as they get ready for their bye week.
The Montreal Alouettes mentioned it a little bit earlier, the fact that they still have two relatively new starters at guard in Ryan Baumann and Christian Matt, replacing the now retired Scott Flory and Andrew Woodruff.
To the end zone for Stafford. That's the Troy Smith, though, right there, what you saw, his ability to evade rushers that you saw back in Ohio State when he was the Heisman Trophy winner. There's a flash there of that ability to buy time.
Yeah, and Tom Higgins has suggested that he'd like to see Troy Smith use his legs a little bit more this season, and that was a side of him, a skill that he had that wasn't really demonstrated last year. Not just using it to escape, but also using it as a weapon. Again, I think that's going to come for Troy Smith with comfort, with developing a little bit of a feel for this game and when those opportunities are going to present themselves. But I'd also like to see the Alouettes, in terms of their play calling, get him on the move a little bit, where he gets out on the edge, where he's got the choice to run or throw, and he becomes a threat in doing so.
Nice catch by Eric Delorier. So time running down here to finish this one off. For the first time in 15 years, the Montreal Alouettes start a quarterback not named Anthony Calvillo. And life without AC is going to be challenging, to say the least. Smith dances again, scrambles now, decides to throw end zone, and incomplete, and flags are thrown. Even though zeros are on the clock, we may have another play here. For the Alouettes, they want to find a way to crack that barrier.
Calgary, number 38, in goal. ball be placed at the 1 yard line, first down.
Well, here's the call here. So they'll place the ball at the one. And the final play of the game, a chance for the Alouettes to cross the goal line.
The only point of the game scored by Montreal came on special teams here, so the defense looking to keep their personal zero intact.
Took them 60 minutes to score, but they do get a major, and it's Stephen Lambala, the former Calgary Dino, comes home to score a touchdown. But a small reward in this one for the Montreal Alouettes, who go down the point after to come. It will be 29-8. Lambala, who is a force here with the Dinos through the years. Younger brother of Rolly Lambala. Great dual back, dual threat. Running and catching.